Lousy. Most of your stuff is, you know, you make violent films and you make dirty films and you make, you know, family films, but just most of them are not very
good, are they?
Hi everybody, my name is Dom Griffin. I'm a film critic and you're watching the Armchair Auteur, an ongoing video series where I talk about movies. If you're the kind of person that loves movies and likes watching people on the internet talk about them, please consider subscribing. Today, we're going to be talking about Warren Beatty. I am well aware that there is nearly nothing going on in the media at the moment to cause me to make a video about Warren Beatty right now. I know he's not like a highly relevant topic in popular culture at the moment. So to begin the video, we're going to talk a little bit about the thought process that brought me to wanting to make a video about Warren Beatty for you guys. So I've been watching this week just like to unwind, like in between the other things I watch researching for future videos and also just things I have to review. I've just been watching like a bunch of random baseline action comedies. Like I watched Stuber and I watched My Spy with Batista. Bit of a Batista fan. And watching these movies, I realized that like certain types of studio fare are designed to kind of work around like a star, like some kind of movie star person. And in our current era, we don't really have movie stars the way we used to have movie stars. Like all the people who you guys know and love from like Marvel movies and stuff, like a few of them are like semi-bankable on their own, and like you'll watch them in a Marvel movie and then you'll watch them do other stuff, but not to the degree that we used to have stars where like you could just plug someone into a kind of a movie and they could carry it on their own. Like, it's sort of like a rare thing now. The main reason I was thinking about this is because of all the action comedies that I watched back to back, the one that was the best was the one that starred an actual movie star. I watched Night and Day with Tom Cruise. That movie is really underrated, and Tom Cruise is incredible in it, and Tom Cruise, as anyone who knows me knows, is the greatest movie star of all time. He's just incredible. The man's got range, hits in every decade that he's been alive, just longevity, impact, like Tom Cruise is great. But even Tom Cruise is not quite like the kind of movie star like we used to have. We used to have these guys who were like powerful and people knew who they were and they had like recognition as actors. And also they helped steer like the direction of their films. Many of them became producers and writers and filmmakers as well. And like today, we've got like Ben Affleck, who's like directed a couple of movies. We've got like George Clooney, who's moved into directing. Bradley Cooper directed recently, you know, A Star Is Born. But like none of them are kind of the type of filmmaker that Warren Beatty was and sort of still is. Warren Beatty to me is like one of the most fascinating movie stars like in the history of movies for the chief reason that like, you know, even like most good-looking movie star guys of a certain era either had like they were really classy or they seemed really, you know, like macho in some way, or you know, dating back to the 40s, someone like Humphrey Bogart, or like these guys, they all had like very specific things that made them stars and made them people we wanted to see on screen again and again and again. And Warren Beatty is like odd to me because his like two warring parts of himself is that like he's like really fuckable, he's like just an insanely hot guy. He's like a total jock who became an actor and like became kind of like an arts intellectual. So no matter what he does, no matter how much range he has as an actor, his wheelhouse is always going to be in playing just unspeakably confident, sexualized men. But then the stories he wants to tell often dovetail with that in some way. But they're usually like a little bit more interesting than that. Like you would not think of him as a guy, the way he acts, who could direct some of the movies that he's directed or has co-written or has co-produced, or he's always had a hand in his own journey. And as a result, he's, after like the 70s era, he's a lot less prolific as well. Like he only has like a few major roles as an actor and he's only directed a handful of movies, but each of those movies is like really unique for good reasons for the most part, and then a couple for bad ones. So that made me really want to like explore his work as a filmmaker, like specifically as a director. Like he's obviously, you know, produced a lot of films and he's starred in several and he's acted in others, but really I kind of wanted to focus on movies where he's like the lead, he's also the producer, he's also the director, he's in some way doing some of the writing, like the ones where he has his hand in all the pots. And watching them, they seem so unique to me compared to like other actors who just become full-on, you know, directors and like they move away from in front of the camera. Someone like Clint Eastwood, who still acts here and there, but like, you know, obviously the older he gets, he just becomes a filmmaker. I'm not gonna get into someone like Clint Eastwood because that's like a whole other video. But watching these three films that I consider to be the best of what makes Warren Beatty work as a movie star, as a Hollywood entity, each of them sort of crisscrossed with some current preoccupations of mine for different reasons. So I kind of thought, oh, I can just talk about these three movies and explore, like, why I thought they were important, what they mean to me, and, like, why I think people should, like, you know, give this man his props. Not to say that Warren Beatty has not had an entire career of getting his props. I just mean that he's not someone that currently I think people talk about enough. Now, the reason for that is because this man, for a very long time, had a very specific kind of mystique and a very specific kind of creative power, and two major failures derailed that power. One of the reasons that Warren Beatty is not, like, the, you know, like, immaculate God King that a lot of people used to think of him as, is because he made Ishtar, and it's really not good. I watched it for the first time ever in my life, researching for this video, and it's not quite as bad as people have always made it out to be. When I was, like, a kid, like, Ishtar was just, like, a synonym for a bad movie. It's not that bad, but it's also, like, just not very good, and I can see how it was just ill-conceived from the start, and no amount of talent involved. Like, there's nothing Elaine May could have done to make this work. Just the premise was just not right. And, of course, more recently, Warren Beatty wrote, directed, and starred in a movie where he plays Howard Hughes, Rules Don't Apply. This is, like, a really not good movie. It's not bad in the sense that you could watch, like, a train wreck and mock it and have fun with it. It just, like, doesn't really work. And nobody wants to see, like, this cocksure, even in his aging years, movie star, playing an eccentric billionaire, whatever, like Howard Hughes. Was Howard Hughes a billionaire? I don't know how rich he ended up actually being before he died. But Howard Hughes is, it just does not fit. Warren Beatty does not have, like, the quirk or mania necessary to bring that to the big screen, and the whole movie's weird and bad, and that's why it flopped when it did. But so those are, like, the last, you know, they're not the last two things he did, but I think those failures definitely cloud the overall vision of him in history. So we are just going to talk about the three bangers that he made that I think no one can really argue with, and if they do, they can go to the comment section and do it, where I'll just roast them for disagreeing with me. Please do that. Quick preface, if you want to get into these three movies, like if you want to have, like, yourself, like, a little movie marathon like I did, I will suggest that you should pregame with two movies that Warren Beatty did not direct on his own. So one is Shampoo, which is directed by Hal Ashby. Hal Ashby is, like, a king, like, one of the greatest filmmakers of all time. Warren Beatty co-wrote that film and produced it, and it's, like, obviously very much about his own psyche. Please, please, please watch Shampoo. It's, like, such an underrated movie. And the other is Heaven Can Wait, which he co-directed with Buck Henry, and was very heavily involved with, and it's just a really sweet movie. It's, like, I know people hate the film versus movie debate, but watching Heaven Can Wait, I just thought, this is, like, such a good movie. Like, everything about that movie, like, really worked for me. And I didn't think it would, but it did. So those two things make, like, a really good, like, appetizer for this smorgasbord.
You and Jack have a lot of middle-class dreams for two radicals. Jack dreams that he can hustle the American working man, whose one dream is to be rich enough not to have to work, into a revolution led by his party. And you dream that if you discuss the revolution with a man before you go to bed with him, it'll be missionary work rather than sex.
So first, we're going to talk about the film Reds. Before we get into the film itself, me personally, like most people in my age bracket over the last few years, I've politically moved much further to the left than I was when I was like 20. And I feel like with every passing day, I move even further. So if, to me, the idea going back and watching Warren Beatty direct a 3-hour movie about socialism, lensed by cinematographer Vittorio Storaro, to me that seemed like amazing. I was like, oh, why haven't I done this sooner? This seems perfect. And then I started watching the movie and I was like, oh, this is like more a movie about how people in leftist art spaces cheat on each other a lot. Reds is sort of a biopic about John Reed, the journalist and activist who covered like the Russian Revolution when it happened. It's really more about John Reed and his wife, Louise Bryant, played by Diane Keaton in the film. It's a very unwieldy film that is very long and spans several years. It has a lot of interviews with the witnesses, like people who were still alive when they shot the film, who were around during this era and knew some of these people that just get interviewed like documentary style, and their interviews are just like plopped in between the narrative. Anyway, it's sort of Warren Beatty, like he does in Shampoo, kind of wrestling with his own image as like a like elite tier womanizer, I suppose, while also wrestling with things that he clearly related to some way in John Reed's life. It's sort of a movie about how we square the things we owe to one another in interpersonal relationships with the things that we are obligated to do for one another via society. So John and Louise's marriage is very tumultuous. It's marked by a lot of distance and a lot of infidelity on both parts. At one point, they're kind of locked in a weird love triangle with the playwright Eugene O'Neill, who was played by Jack Nicholson in the film, who's like incredible. But throughout their lives in the film, all the moments in the film where they seem the most closely together are the ones where they're the most closely allied politically by the movements that they're a part of. Like specifically in the middle part of what feels like a two-part film, when they actually witness the Russian Revolution, like they just get swept up in it and they seem so close and things seem to be kind of working. It's in all the other parts of their lives where they differ on different ideas about the movement, about politics, about labor, about all these different things. And obviously a lot of it is John personally having to wrestle with, is he going to be content just being a great writer and somewhat a propagandist who's a good husband while also being a part of the revolution, being a revolutionary? Can he be both those things at once? Can he do any of them well at the same time? Can he juggle it? And Warren Beatty is really good at pulling that off. Like he captures how like charismatic and interesting whatever John Reed was at the time, but he also captures how like there's a limit to that. There's a limit to just being like smart and funny and good looking or whatever, because you know you can inspire certain things, but the closer he gets to having to do real work in the movement, like it doesn't jibe with him. I think one of the reasons I love Warren Beatty's performance in this movie is that like at a very baseline, as long as this movie is as complex and thorny as it is, his take on John Reed boils down to like a dude who has like very strong convictions and doesn't like being edited, kind of. I know it's a silly thing, but there's this one really great scene where he's arguing with Gene Hackman, who's playing one of his editors, this very reactionary guy who's always like trying to like change his words, and he's just like laying into him, like, you know, don't change my prose, don't change my writing, it's not right. And then later, once he's like working with the Russians and like the Russian Revolution is over and like he's starting to have some ideological differences with the structure of things, he finds himself in a position where he's written a speech and it's been completely rewritten without his knowledge. And it's like the same thing he was dealing with before he got into this entire racket. And he just like lays into those with the Russians like the same way he did his editor. It's like he's so like singular-minded. And it, to me, it highlighted what it is about Warren Beatty as a filmmaker that made him so unique. Not that every filmmaker obviously doesn't, you know, cares about creative freedom, but Beatty's like just a really hard-headed guy who, I feel like the main reason he slowly stopped making more films was because he didn't want to make any story or be involved in any production where he didn't have more control, either as a producer, shielding a filmmaker he personally trusted, or just directing himself because he felt like, I know how this is supposed to go, no one else seems to get it, I've got it, I'll just take care of it. And that's not always, like, correct. I mean, there's gotta have been situations where Warren Beatty argued with someone at the studio or someone on set and, like, they were right and he just was Warren Beatty. But there's something kind of admirable about that too, thinking about how in today's world there's a very, very few filmmakers who have the power to like get the things done that they want to get done. And, you know, someone like Christopher Nolan, but like they're largely making movies that are, you know, bigger and bigger spectacles for summer tentpole releases and stuff. And, you know, Warren Beatty wasn't really doing that. Like Warren Beatty was, you know, trying to tell like really good stories and finding avenues for his own performances. And to me, in that regard, Reds is really good. I mean, it has screenwriters like Bo Goldman and Lane May working on the script, which is like kind of all over the place. But some of the human moments in the film, some of the moments just between the characters wrestling with who they are and like what they need and what they can do for one another, is like they're so incisive and cutting, and the acting is so good that you kind of don't care how long the movie is. You kind of don't care how like wide a swath everything cuts. Like, because those human moments really ring true and they really cut deep. I was really, really caught off guard by it. To me, Reds is interesting because I feel like at this time, in this era, Warren Beatty was sort of like a progressive, like, lefty filmmaker telling this big, broad story. And, like, when you look later in, like, the early 2000s and stuff, when filmmakers like George Clooney started trying to have more of a voice and be more political in their movies, they ended up with, like, a lot of these sort of middle-of-the-road, boring lib takes on semi-current events that are all sort of mishmashy and, like, not really impactful. And, like, they were up for awards, and people loved them at the time, but, like, that entire era, like Syriana and movies like that, like, nobody actually gives a shit about them. No one quotes them today. No one talks about them. People don't revisit them. The era of people reacting to the Bush politics of the time and stuff, like, those movies are so, like, just boring. And, like, a lot of them are just not good. And I feel like Reds stands like in such stark contrast to that. And obviously that also has to do with the way the industry itself has changed. It's not all like these new guys suck and Beatty's great, but Beatty is pretty tight.
Oh,
film we have to talk about is Dick Tracy. Now, I've seen Dick Tracy before. I'd watched Dick Tracy as a child. I was really into the iconography and like that marketing campaign as a kid. I thought it looked really cool. I didn't think it looked really cool as a marketing campaign as a child. I just thought it looked really awesome. It was like the only thing that was as cool looking and seeming as the marketing campaign stuff for the Tim Burton 89 Batman movie. Obviously, this movie is sort of designed to capture a bit of that zeitgeist, but it's going to be difficult to say this to a lot of my Batman fans, and everyone knows how much I love Batman. Dick Tracy is just a much better movie overall, just everything about it. You know, one of the things that's been on my mind a lot today is that on this channel, you know, we talk about comic book movies a lot. I bring up superheroes a lot, and I know it probably makes me seem like slightly less of an intellectual, but, you know, most modern comic book movies, there's just this ceiling on how unique or interesting they can be, okay? Like, everything that's made on the Marvel side is all made to the same house style to keep the money rolling in, and those movies are all pretty fun for the most part, and like they're very well liked, and I get it, but like there's a limit on how good they can really be because no one involved is really getting to make kind of really bold choices. The closest you get to bold choice in the Marvel world is what, you know, like AM radio song James Gunn's gonna slide into the soundtrack, and like to me that's kind of a low bar. But across the street, the DC movies do attempt to get real, you know, filmmakers with vision and, like, claim they're going to get out of their way, but then at some point, studio meddling takes over, and these movies become, like, these kind of, you know, wishy-washy half-measures themselves. There's very clearly an attempt to make something specific and unique with some vision, but very rarely does it actually come all the way to fruition, right? So that also sucks. Dick Tracy is this really unique and weird moment where a movie star is directing and producing the movie himself, partially owns the rights, is involved with the writing of the movie, and several other uncredited writers as well, obviously. Like, the actual development process for this movie is a bit of a mess. And he creates, like, this perfect art object. It's mind-blowing to me that people don't give Dick Tracy more props. Like, this man brought in Vittorio Storaro, again, like, amazing cinematographer, and the production design, and the using, like, these bold colors and using matte paintings to fill out the back of the city skylines and stuff to make it feel like the 1930s, and just deciding, fuck it, we're making a movie based on a 1930s comic strip, let's make the whole fucking movie look like a 1930s comic strip, let's get Stephen Sondheim in here to write the music, let's get Madonna singing like these big old show tunes, let's just have every Dick Tracy villain that's designed by Chester Gould to look like an ugly fuck, let's just make ugly fuck makeup and hide brilliant actors behind that ugly fuck makeup. Let's get James Caan and Dustin Hoffman and fucking Al Pacino and all these other great, great, great actors just to, like, show up and be in this kids' cartoon, you know? And, like, as a result, it feels like a cartoon. It feels like something that's, you know, for kids can enjoy it. As a kid, I thought Dick Tracy was tight. But as an adult, it's actually still really engrossing. It's just gorgeous to look at. Like, every frame of the movie is pretty as shit. And there's just no other movie that's based on a comic strip or a comic that, like, has that feel, okay? Like, it's timeless. Like, watching it today, it just still looks pretty as fuck. Like, it still looks pristine, you know? And you can fire up all your MCU color grading arguments or DC's too dark and gloomy or whatever, but, like, watching a movie where Warren Beatty, one of the baddest men, like, ever, is rolling around in, like, this stark canary banana yellow coat just stunting at all times and fighting bad guys, and, like, there's a cool little crime plot and stuff, like, that's a movie, you know? That's, like, that is straight up and down a perfect movie. And every time I see people's complaints about it, I'm always like, who, what? That's all the different boring and milquetoast movies we've forgiven over the years because they feature characters we like, and we're not gonna, like, raise a candle at Dick Tracy? We're not just gonna look at that and look at everything that's come since and go, this was the bar and no one's bothered to try to crack it since? It's the perfect movie, and I really wish more people would give Dick Tracy its props. Like, it's out there, it's not hard to find to watch, like, it's fucking perfect.
Since civil unrest went down about 4 years ago, you promised us federal funding to rebuild our community. What happened?
Well, what happened was that we all knew that was going to be big news for a while, so we all came down here, Bush, Clinton, Wilson, all of us. We got our pictures taken, told you what you wanted to hear, and we
pretty much forgot about it.
Did he just say what I think he said?
Let's see where he's going with this.
We can't get health insurance, fire insurance, life insurance.
life insurance, why haven't you come out for Senate Bill 2720?
Well, because you haven't really contributed any money to my campaign, have you? You got any idea how much these insurance companies come up with? They pretty much depend on me to get a bill like that and bottle it up in my committee during an election, and in that way, we can kill it when you're not looking.
Now, for the third film, slightly less perfect, we have to talk about the last time anybody gave a shit what Warren Beatty did, and that is 1988's Bulworth. So, I remember watching Bulworth, like, as a kid. I was 12, 13, maybe, I guess. I watched pretty much every movie made between 1995 and 1999 when I was a kid, because my grandmother had a membership card for every video rental store in, like, the Tri-State area, and she just rented videos nonstop. And when I went to visit her, I watched movies nonstop. This is what I did as a kid. That's how I turned out, how I turned out. And Bulworth, when I was a kid, I thought, like, oh, it's the guy from Dick Tracy. He's older. Political stuff. I don't know. Like, every political movie kind of blended to me. Like, Primary Colors, Wag the Dog, whatever. Like, it was all kind of the same movie. I didn't know any better. And watching it then, I just thought, like, oh, this is, like, funny or charming or whatever. But I didn't, like, know. Watching it now, I understand why the movie was so problematic when it came out. And I'm not going to pretend that the movie does not have some serious, serious flaws. Just the entire idea of making a two-hour movie that heavily involves Warren Beatty rapping, it's a bad idea. Just right off the bat, it's a bad idea. You can tell it's the sort of satirical thing that, like, maybe if he'd made it with Hal Ashby could have been, like, better or could have, like, worked a little better somehow. But, like, it's a difficult concept to pull off, and he doesn't execute it quite right. The entire word subplot where Warren Beatty falls in love with Halle Berry and she, like, responds and feels the same. Clearly, Warren Beatty, old man, horny hubris. Okay, like, I can't defend that. But the movie itself, Bulworth, if you don't know, is a film where Warren Beatty plays a Democratic senator who's trying, he's an incumbent, he's trying to fight off, like, this new populist, more right-leaning young guy who's, like, trying to take a spot in a primary. It's said to be 1996, like, right after Bob Dole got the Republican nomination and Bill Clinton had already clinched the Democratic nomination because he was president. And the character Bulworth has completely, utterly given up on life and completely sold out his values. He's very clearly someone who was, like, a radical in the 60s and 70s, and now he's just in debt to insurance companies. He does nothing for his constituents. He's bought and paid for. And he hates himself for it. And, like, he basically wants to die. He's suicidal, in fact. And hires a hitman to kill him so he doesn't have to deal with this anymore. But because he's been staying up and drinking and is miserable, he ends up going to a black church for, like, a typical Democratic senator suck up to black people event. And just goes off script. And says a bunch of wild shit. And everyone, like, goes mad. And in doing that, and just freely letting go and saying whatever he wants to say, he becomes this, like, hot take machine. And becomes a big media sensation. And he realizes he actually doesn't want to die now because he likes letting all this stuff out. So most of the movie, he's, like, terrified of the guy that he hired to kill him. And then later there's a twist about who the actual hitman is, blah, 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 blah. But the actual good parts of the movie is that he becomes this living shock machine sort of designed to agitate, like, what the modern Democratic Party has become, which is, like, a joke. This is, like, 98, you know? And, like, watching it then, I don't know how people... I mean, like, I know I've read how people react to the movie then, but I don't know. I wasn't, you know... Watching it today, like, this movie is, like, comically relevant. Like, it painfully so. Like, all of the weird stuff that he says and does is, like, incredibly in line with, like, the way Trump became president. You know what I mean? Like, minus all the, like, catering to, like, white nationalists. So it's very prescient in that regard. Like, just how much the media loves, like, a crazy thing to happen. But it's really, to me, the important part is, like, Warren Beatty, like, was, like a more radical person when he was younger, and, like, it seems like a big call-out post, so to speak, for himself and all his peers, you know? Like, we used to stand for something, we used to believe in things, we wanted to change the world, and now we're older and we have money and we're beholden to corporate overlords and we don't give a fuck about anybody, and worse, we pretend that's not the case. Like, that's, like, the most painful part of it all. It's not so much just that people are bought and paid for and they don't care. It's that they pretend they do care. And that hurts. Like, just knowing that there are all these people who claim to be fighting for you. And for the most part, they're just, like, slightly better than the people that are the actual villains, you know? And, like, to me, Bulworth really captures that feeling very well. Like, there are so many moments in this movie that when I was watching it, I was just like, oh, wow, just the other day, Joe Biden was telling me I wasn't black if I didn't want to vote for him. So, like, you know, watching this movie and seeing Jay Bulworth say all this crazy stuff and like trying to like talk hood and starting trying to like rap and shit. It's like ridiculous. And people at the time were like, oh, this is so like stupid. But like, I don't know, watch the video of Hillary dabbing. Like, it's not that ridiculous. I think what makes the movie even more poignant and funny too is like Oliver Platt is in it, and so is like Josh Molina. So it definitely makes the entire movie feel sort of like a Insomniac shit posters like dream version of an episode of The West Wing. Like, it deals with all the politics stuff, but with like none of the idealism whatsoever. It's all just dashed away. And there's so many little moments that like within the larger movie that doesn't quite play right and kind of gets a lot of things wrong that play really well. Like, there's an entire scene where a cop's about to just like straight up assault a child. And like the only reason that he doesn't is because Warren Beatty steps in and they recognize that he's a senator, you know? And like, that's supposed to be like a crazy scene, but like, that's just like how the world goes now. Watching it again, I'm like, you know, Bulworth has some problems. I mean, the fact that Bulworth's like ultimate expression of like fixing systemic racism is just to like have more mixed race babies is like fucking stupid. But, you know, compared to like, you know, another actor turned filmmaker's personal politics, like Clint Eastwood or something, like, it's like, you know, miles ahead. And watching the entire thing, it's like, yes, there are elements that are like ill-conceived, and like the entire idea that he and his co-screenwriter were so proud of like writing a bunch of rap dialogue for Warren Beatty to spew is that like there's an entire section of the movie where he really is just rapping almost all his dialogue. And I remember thinking, like, this is just blind spotting. Like, blind spotting is a good movie and I mostly like it, but like, this is the same thing. And people love that shit, so I don't know, it's just weird that people hated it then. But it just, like, thinking about the whole thing, I just remember being like, man, like, this guy is from a very different era, and even at, like, the end of his sort of creative usefulness, I guess we can say, he was still cranking out a movie that had just so much, like, chaotic energy. And I think the main reason it has the power to push through, even with this, like, problematic and, like, unsure premise, is that Warren Beatty has always been, like, the star quarterback of acting and filmmaking. He's just like, look, here's what we're doing, and I'm gonna keep pushing through because, like, I'm Warren Beatty, and I'm gonna use, like, the megaton magnetic power of my own charisma to get this story through. And seeing it for this, you know, uneven, but, like, engrossing and somewhat humorous political film, I was just like, yeah, man, I miss that. We don't really have that anymore. That's kind of tragic. I mean, I don't know, there's definitely more tragic things in the world than, like, we don't have, like, a white movie star making millions, doing whatever the fuck he wants. But, like, rewatching the movie, I just kind of kept thinking, like, you know what? Lots of people have made shitty movies. Lots of people have made shittier movies than Ishtar and Rules Don't Apply. Maybe we should let these blemishes make us forget just how dope an artist Warren Beatty was. And theoretically, still is. Like, maybe he's got one more movie in it. Maybe he's got one more movie where he plays, like, I don't know, an octogenarian stud or something. Like, maybe not, probably not, but, like, maybe. So that's the video for today, guys. If you're interested in doing this triple feature, please do. And let me know what happened. Like, tell me in the comments, like, what you think or how you feel about the movies. Tell me what you think about Warren Beatty. If you have any particularly humorous fantasies about him, you can feel free to share those. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you have not subscribed, please consider subscribing. If you do subscribe, hit the little bell icon so you get notifications when I put up future videos. We've got more reviews coming next week. More sort of think PC topics like this. And you'll get notified whenever a new video drops. So thank you guys very much. I hope everyone's staying safe and sane. There's a lot of really, really terrible things happening in the news right now that are very, very emotionally exhausting. And if those things are affecting you, I really hope that you're in a place where you can tune it out. And if you need to take a break from looking at a timeline full of depressing news, there is nothing wrong with zoning out and finding something to take your mind off of it. Do not punish yourselves. The world's still going to be just as harsh when you come back from your break. Please stay safe. Have a great day, guys.